We are right in the middle of that section on page Chavtes. The line begins with the word na-asim. Yeah. And the Rebbe is taking very great pains to make sure we understand that the fact that there is by Hillel and Shammai ultimately Chesed and Gvura in a very narrowly defined form, meaning exact Chesed and not Gvura, and Gvura and not Chesed, that is not exclusively due to their individual kelim, individual ways of understanding things. Rather, yes, it is certainly their individual way of taking things, it plays a very major role. But what they are defining with their individual inclination is they are defining the chesed gvura that is inherent in the sechel harav, in the teaching of the rav. And if not for the teaching, for the fact that it is contained within the intention of Rab, then they would not have the Chesed and Gvura in their own understanding, individualized understanding. And the emphasis on this is, of course, they can understand the way they choose to understand. Why would they not be able to understand it without the sechel or rav, if this is their inclination? And the answer is, and this is what the emphasis over here, they would definitely be able to understand it that way. But only on the kelim level, not on the oir level. Oir emanates from a true source of oir. Oir is not being created in the mitzvahs of the world. Therefore, in order to have Oir HaChesed and Oir HaGvura, that has to be rooted in a seichel, in a seichel that contains Chesed and Gvura. And we had multiple ways of illustrating this phenomenon. All right, so we're on the line that begins with the word na'asim b'v'china seir v'chesed v'hankbura. And yet still, although that ultimately it becomes oil ha-chesed and oil ha-gvura. And when you say it's oil ha-chesed, not kli ha-chesed, but oil ha-chesed. Kli ha-chesed is a kind of a inadvertent result. But oil ha-chesed, that is not inadvertent. That is only exists only because there is an intent for it.
Right, Paltiel, what does it mean that
Kli
is inadvertent?
That
Kli
what?
Kli is inadvertent. What does that mean?
All right. Inadvertent means the following. You have water in a cup. The reason you have water in a cup, not because you have water in a cup per se, but because you need to drink. And the only way for you to drink is by using a cup. Water does not per se belong in a cup. There's a certain function of water that cannot be accomplished without a cup. And for that reason, you put it in a cup. But it doesn't per se belong. Water belongs in a lake, in an ocean, in a river. It doesn't belong in a cup. Hello?
Yeah.
I'm looking at a calendar of yours. Go ahead.
It comes from the world rather than it comes from the intention of the.
It comes from the function of the keli, right? Oil justifies itself. Oil has real presence. And therefore, if we say that it has real presence, it has to have a real source. Or it cannot be the result of some kind of a circumstance. You constantly, I don't see, a living reaction over here. I hear that you understand it. We speak, any kind of song, just a very simple thing. We speak in terms of ownership. There's ownership as it is understood, the conventional ownership in the world. There is ownership as we speak in terms of oir, in terms of a Torah perspective. A totally different concept. Ownership in a conventional sense is the result of many people being together in order to prevent a clash between them, and that each one should have what he needs. We have ownership, principles of ownership, rules of ownership, rules that separate them. The whole concept is created on the spot, so to speak, inadvertently. This is the keli. So the oir? No, the oir says there is a principle of ownership. And that is possible only because the whole mitzvah of the world has an owner. And it is from that ownership that is disseminated to the individual owner. This is oir. Oir comes from a source of oir. Doesn't it create as a response to certain circumstances? No, what about now? Shlemi Innocence has not arrived yet.
I don't have a
question.
Thank
you,
I understand.
What? That. I don't have a
question. Thank you. You don't have a question? Why don't you have a question?
I don't know.
All right, let's give him a pinch to wake him up a bit.
So why isn't it so obvious that of this, it seems like from the worldly perspective and our perspective, where there's no such thing as light. Like it's like
all right, let's leave that alone.
Yeah. I thought that would be the pinch though.
Oh, human pinch. No, you have to give me a pinch, a physical pinch. I'm a KD level. You know the
I didn't get that Nakuta inadvertently. What's the difference inadvertently from Kaila than through Oyer?
No, Oyer cannot be inadvertent. Oyer is only intentional. Has a source. Sheira Shu Mokir. Keli does not. Keli is circumstantial. That's meant inadvertent.
Meaning to say, if I can drink the water with other cup, I will do it that way. That's the point.
Yeah, that's right. The whole relationship between water and the cup is only at the moment when you use it. Functional.
And from oil, it's not about convenience. It's about the truth.
That's right.
So the Hillel and Shammai have to approach the or of their masters with their own or before they bring approach it to Keli.
They approach it with their Keli. And with their Keli, they detect the oil that belongs to them within the oil of their master.
It belongs to them. There's a certain light originally that was intended for them.
Inherent in the oil, in the sechel of the lab is contained the oil that fits each one of them.
You lose the or if the Keli did not approach the or, it only figured things out on itself, by itself.
What might again?
The Keli would be absent of the or if the Keli figured things out on the Keli level.
Yeah, without that, then it's a boy, it's that's right. The table doesn't come to life because it has four legs and stands. Does the table stand? A human being stands because he has oil that holds him up. The table doesn't stand. Right. You're having some difficulty, is not, you know, but I'd like to take the few moments that we have to break through this difficulty. Use a keli to drink when you're thirsty. Therefore, there's a reason for you to have a keli. Otherwise, you'll be thirsty. So something compelling, something demanding, come on, go and drink something because you're thirsty. What is a compelling element in oil that you should want to understand? Oil ha-sechel.
From talking about water and a keli to or ha-sechel.
I'm saying or ha-sechel is or ha-sechel.
It seems to me that if you did not have or within yourself, you would not approach the or of the sechel, of the rope.
That's right. It's okay. Right. Very good. Okay. So now, what is this or that you have within yourself? Identify it. That's before you learn the sechel. You're learning the sechel from the Rav. What brings you to the Rav to want to learn?
Is it correct to say that if we lack oil, then it's lacking significance, and the person is looking for some meaning?
Why is he looking for a meaning?
Because that's him.
In what way is it him? If he is first identifying the meaning after he learns, so how is it him? It's good. I mean, I'm not refuting what you say.
No,
I want you to finish it. Finish the whole sentence.
He senses that in order to get meaning, this is the way how to get it.
Why does he want meaning? What does he need meaning for?
He's not just a plain piece of Kaila, he's a thriving being, he wants that person,
has a neshama. Right, he has a neshama, very good. So can we in any which way name or refer to that element in the neshama that compels it to go and try to understand and find meaning?
Ratzon.
What?
Ratzon.
Speak up, sir.
Ratzon.
That we always say. Preceding all seichel is the rotz. I live not by default, not because I fed my body. I live because I want to live. And in this wanting to live is reflected the sense that life is all around me. Life is the truth that I relate to. And I want to relate to that truth. That's what will is. When I say I want to live, does not mean I want to live, not I don't want to die. I don't want to suffer the burial. Just like I don't want to suffer hunger. I want to live is a completely different thing.
the pamphlet that the light is outside of the person and he has a rotzen, he wants to wear afterward.
The rotzen, this rotzen, has a different definition than rotzen, I want to drink.
What's the difference? What's
the difference?
Because then it's ourselves, it's not outside of ourselves.
The rotzen I want to drink is that I don't want to be thirsty. The rotzen I want to live is not I don't want to die. That's not the rotzen I want to live. It's a completely self-contained element. It's called wanting, but it does not mean wanting that in lieu of something of the opposite. I want it because I want it. Because this is the only thing that's wantable.
It comes from above us.
It comes from above us. It comes from our neshama.
Put into us. So it's.
That's exactly right. This comes to us along with the gift of the neshama.
Neshama suffers though when it doesn't. When it's not like. Fulfilling the rotzen, its rotzen, pursuing the rotzen of the Eibishter and doing Israel, it suffers though. Is that not considered a negative component to it? Person
is thirsty and he's suffering from thirst. Is the suffering from thirst reflect his desire to drink? Answer my question. He's suffering thirst because he wants to drink.
He's
suffering from thirst because you're suffering from thirst. When you want, when somebody's suffering because he doesn't have life, it's because it wants to live. It has a sense of life. Not because it's above its lack.
The neshama
is definitely alive. And this thing that the neshama is alive is reflected not just in the fact that it is alive and not dead, but the life has a message. It's actively alive. He wants to express its life.
Is it that to say that he wants to express itself beyond itself, like in the good?
No, not because he wants to express it in the goof. A physical entity only knows itself and it does nothing else exists. life in the neshama, life is per se reflective of the life of the source of life. Life does not exist independently of the source of life. And if you want to pursue and try to understand this will of the neshama to live, so I give up. Because that is not really possible to identify. The only thing that we can identify is recognize, yes, indeed, there is such a thing.
So are we calling, Ron said that this is rotzon. Is this the or? The or is the or
source of the oyer, hasechel, is rotzon.
We're speaking now about the Shammai and Hillel. It's their rotzon, this is what brings their kelim to approach the or of the rod.
This is what brings their oyer, their will to the rov.
Their will.
Yeah.
But the only tool they have is their kelim.
No, they have sechel. They have kelim to be able to understand the sechel. But you understand sechel because they have the highest of the rotzon ha-nefesh.
Again, they have
the highest of the nefesh, and they're living human beings. They have the rotzon coming from the nefesh, and this is why they're able to understand the sechel that's being given to them.
No, the aura of the Rav is also his expression, so to speak. It becomes from his essence, the aura becomes beginning of a keli, so to speak, as he's bringing it down from his essence.
That's what I mean, done in seichel. Seichel is able to be mislabish in a keli, in clear seichel.
This is where he brought this aura into a seichel that Hillel and Shammai can approach with.
Can approach and understand, exactly right. But because they're able to understand it, that does not make them seek to understand it. The reason they seek to understand it is because they have this rotzon hanefesh to understand.
Both the Rav and the Mekablim they begin with or, with a rotzon.
That's right. Absolutely right. Like we say all the time, regardless of how compelling your sechel is, it's never going to affect a dog. Even if you train a dog to mimic human behavior, it will never become a human being. Sorry to say that, but that's a fact.
The point of that distinction is to highlight this unique soul quality of Ratzon.
Yeah. To a human being, before anything, and you say, there is right and wrong, there is good and bad, there is true and false. Not because he knows truth and he knows falseness. but because of the quality of his life. He lives with oyer. Not with the tchila, with compelling element on the gashmistic level. Like we say all the time, we quote from the story with the guy said, I want to eat so that I would live, not so that I won't be hungry. That's human sechel.
We're saying that's the preeminent human quality.
That's right.
The person knows that this true, false, good, bad. He's saying that this is rooted in the ratzon.
Yeah.
This is not, it's not seichel.
No, this is in seichel, but it's not the seichel that's compelling it. It's the ratzon that brings out the seichel. This is what you're saying over here. In the Sheva Shumoka, there is that Indian. The Sheva Shumoka of Sechel is Rotsa. The right way for a human being to drink is from a cup. That's after Sechel. But who says I have to drink in the right way?
Says.
That's what Rotson says. I want to be a human being. There's nothing to do with Seichel.
And when they say all is fair in love and war.
What?
When they try to trump right and wrong by saying love or war, these are situations where that Seichel is preeminent.
That Seichel is preeminent because it has a source. A preeminent source in the nefesh. I want to be a human being. That's primary. Sechel identifies how that translates in practice.
Then why do we need a rav?
You don't need a rav. Not you. You can pass it for yourself. When you're a teacher, we need a rav because to draw that seichel from the source of seichel, you need it all. That's your question, yes. To draw it from the source of seichel, you need somebody who is closer to that source.
A kugel. Yeah.
All right.
Or Star Trek.
This is it for this morning.
So.